A lot of diets out there are backed by people who swear they work. You may have seen it yourself. For example, you have that office friend who lost weight doing keto. You have your mom who lost weight doing paleo. And yes, all of these diets can work. And there's no one best diet for everybody. So to understand what diet will work best for you need to understand the basic principles behind weight loss, the science behind weight loss, and why diets work. The reason that any diet works is because you've created a calorie deficit. It all comes down to that one thing. So, if you eat fewer calories than you burn, you're going to lose weight. If you eat more calories than you burn, you're going to gain weight. And if you're eating about the same calories as you're burning, you're maintaining your weight. And if you're not losing weight, you're not in a calorie deficit. It really is that simple. Despite what some people think, cutting out certain food groups or certain foods won't necessarily help you lose weight unless you're reducing calories. So again, it comes down to calories. And trying to manipulate insulin levels won't have much of an effect either, because it's not insulin itself that is going to help you lose fat. It's again lowering those calories. But many of the diets out there can help people eat fewer calories, especially if that diet aligns with a person's food preferences and helps to create behavior change. So to decide what diet is best for you, you're going to look at five key things. The first is how effectively a diet is going to help you get into a calorie deficit. So the most superior diets for this are probably going to be things like flexible dieting and calorie counting, because you're actually measuring out serving sizes and recording your food intake and figuring out exact calorie amounts. It's hard to go wrong here. Diets that aren't going to be quite as effective, but can still work for many people, are going to be things like your low-fat diets, okay? Because when you're cutting down fat, you're automatically cutting out a lot of calories. You're also cutting out a lot of hyper-palatable foods, meaning foods that are really delicious and easy to overeat. Now, a lot of these hyper-palatable foods are going to be processed foods. And companies create really good tasting foods by combining a certain amount of sugar, fat, carbs, right, and salt. And these things are really delicious, but they're also packed with a lot of calories. So by nature of going on a low-fat diet, you'll be cutting a lot of these things out. Now you're doing something similar if you're choosing to eat clean or go on a paleo diet. Here you're cutting out a lot of processed foods. Again, these foods tend to have higher calories, and you're also going to be eating a lot of fiber-rich, micronutrient-dense foods. Now these fiber-rich foods are going to tend to be more filling, so you'll be less likely to overeat calories. Now, vegan and gluten-free diets work on this same principle. By nature of turning towards less processed foods and more whole, fiber-rich foods, you tend to eat less. Now, within the last 10 years or so, companies are creating better tasting vegan and gluten-free products. These tend to be a little bit higher calorie, of course, so that may lessen the impact of these diets on weight loss. The ketogenic diet and the carnivore diet are each getting a lot of attention these days. And you're not necessarily tracking your food intake, but these diets both still hold a pretty good advantage for weight loss because they help you spontaneously reduce your calorie intake simply because they're so appetite suppressing. Now, how are they doing this? Okay, both of these diets tend to be very low in carbs and high in both protein and fat. When you drop your carbs, studies show that this helps reduce insulin levels and also reduce ghrelin levels. Now, both of these can increase appetite when they're high. Both of these diets also increase ketone body production, and these molecules in and of themselves have been suggested to be appetite suppressing. And finally, let's talk a little bit about meal replacements, because these are very calorie controlled, even though you're not necessarily tracking those calories. They're prepackaged for you, and they help reduce your calorie intake. So they can be a very powerful way to lose weight. But at the end of the day, the diets that tend to be the best for lowering calories are those where you're actually tracking your intake. The second thing you'll want to look at when choosing a diet is how good that diet is for muscle retention. When you're dropping your calories super low, or you're not eating enough protein, which tends to happen on a lot of the diets out there, you're going to put yourself at risk for losing muscle. Now, we want to maintain as much muscle as possible on a diet because not only does it look good, let's face it, but you also want to try to maintain your metabolism and keep that running as high as possible after the diet's finished. To optimally preserve muscle while on a diet, you'll want to choose a good weight training program because that's going to be the best way to help you keep muscle. But also, you'll want to pay close attention to the amount of calories you're eating and the amount of protein you're eating. Now, the best diet for preserving muscle is probably going to be flexible dieting because you're carefully controlling your protein intake and you're also tracking your calories, and you can make sure that neither of those drop too low. Other diets that are good are going to be like paleo, keto diets, the carnivore diet, right? Because you are keeping your protein up so high just by the nature of what you're allowed to eat. And then diets that aren't going to be so good for this are going to be things like your very low calorie diets, right? Like where you're using a super low calorie meal replacement, especially if that meal replacement is a little bit lower in protein. Other diets that are bad are going to be like detox diets where you're just starving yourself, or diets like juice cleanses, right? Because you're just eating juice. There's not a whole lot of calories in that. Really, it's mostly just carbs and sugar, and there's very little protein. The third thing you'll want to look at when choosing a diet is whether that diet can cause adverse outcomes to your health. For example, things like increasing your blood lipids or reducing insulin sensitivity or even causing vitamin or mineral deficiencies. For example, vegan diets are known to cause deficiency if you're not eating the right foods and supplementing well. Vegans will need to make sure to take a B12 supplement because B12 is only found in animal products. Also, they tend to get a lot of omega-3 sources from plants that are rich in ALA omega-3, and this is poorly converted to EPA and DHA. So you'll probably want to take an EPA-DHA supplement from algae. People following a ketogenic diet or a carnivore diet may also need to supplement with a good multivitamin and mineral. These people tend to fall short in calcium, vitamin D, B vitamins, and trace minerals such as selenium. Furthermore, these diets may tend to put someone at risk for developing kidney stones and may also impair high-intensity athletic performance in the gym. The ketogenic diet has also been shown to raise LDL cholesterol in some people, which may predispose them to developing heart disease. Now, there's still a little bit of a debate among some scientists, but that's where the evidence seems to be going. So you'll probably notice that a lot of the diets that I've been talking about that can cause adverse outcomes are those that reduce the certain types of food that people can eat and cut out whole food groups together. The less variety you have, the more likely it is to cause one of these bad outcomes. So that being said, let's talk a little bit about the paleo diet, because this does limit the different types of food that can be eaten, but it doesn't necessarily restrict whole food groups. This diet probably won't cause outright deficiencies, but it does unnecessarily restrict certain foods that have been shown to have a beneficial effect on health. For example, dairy and legumes. Keep in mind that diets that unnecessarily restrict you to eating certain types of food can also have poor psychological outcomes, right? Because you might end up craving those foods and then eventually kind of falling off the wagon and overeating, which can lead to weight gain. Now, this brings me to point number 4, which is you want to choose a diet that aligns with your food preferences and tolerances. Because if you can't stick to a diet, it won't work. I don't care how well designed that diet is and how scientifically valid it is. For example, intermittent fasting. This is a great diet. It can really help you reduce your calorie intake without a lot of thought. Because let's face it, not eating or eating a very small amount 1 or 2 days a week can really help keep that average down. But if you're starving and you're hangry and you're getting a headache and you can't stick to it, it's not going to work. Same goes for things like keto or paleo. If you're going to fall off the wagon and be craving the foods that you're supposed to be cutting out and they're going to help you reduce your calories, it's not going to work for you. Same with very low calorie diets. Are you going to lose a lot of body fat if you're able to follow that? Heck yeah, you are. But can you follow it? That's the question. And flexible dieting. No one will argue that this isn't a very scientifically valid way to retain a lot of muscle while losing a lot of body fat. But if you can't accurately weigh your foods and you're not willing to track and log all the foods you're eating, then it's not going to work for you. And finally, the 5th thing you want to look at when choosing a diet is whether that diet is going to be sustainable for you to follow over the long term. So if you're doing something to lose weight, like drinking meal replacement shakes, or you're ordering all of your food online, for example, using Nutrisystem or something where they're calculating the calories for you, you'll come off that diet and you won't know how to eat to keep the weight off. That's not something you can continue to do forever. The same goes for some people when they choose a diet like paleo or keto or a vegan diet or a gluten-free diet. You might not be able to cut out those certain foods forever. You might find yourself craving those foods, falling off the wagon, and then gaining all the weight back. So the diets that are probably going to allow you to have the most success are those that allow you to eat a variety of food and also to continue eating the foods that you love. So I want to talk a little bit about very low calorie diets right here. Now, because you're just looking at your calorie intake, you're not necessarily cutting out different types of foods. So is this sustainable? Well, obviously, keeping your calories super low over the long term isn't sustainable, but that's not to say that this diet is necessarily bad. If you're keeping your protein up and you have a good exit strategy, you know exactly what to do once you're off the diet, this can be okay, especially for people who have a medical reason to lose weight. For example, people with diabetes or people who need to lose weight prior to a surgery. If you want to lose weight fast, obviously going on a very low-calorie diet is going to be the thing that you might want to do. So it's not bad in every situation. You just need to make sure that you have a plan for coming out of that diet. But I think in general, the most effective diets for the long term are going to be those that actually teach you how to eat for life. So you're learning which foods are lower in calories, which foods are higher in fat or carbs, which foods are high in protein, and you kind of learn what you need to feed your body in order to keep that weight off. Now, this is where flexible dieting really has an upper hand because, again, throughout that whole process where you're weighing your foods, you're entering your serving sizes of things, and you're logging each specific food, you start to learn what is in the food you're eating, and then you learn how to keep the weight off. But to summarize everything, there is no one best diet that works well for everybody. Lots of diets can work. You'll just want to look at five things. One, how effectively that diet can help you reduce your calories. Two, how good is it for muscle retention? Three, whether it can cause negative outcomes. Four, whether it aligns with your preferences and food tolerances. And five, is it sustainable? Is it something you can do for the long term? And is it teaching you how to eat for life? Those are all the things you'll want to look at to choose the best diet for you.